I don't know what I did, but I'm sorry. Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. Let's begin in prayer. Lord, it was as we listened to the words of your servant Job, pouring out his anguish and distress. Thank you that you gather us into yourself. Thank you that you not only allow us to pray hard prayers, but you encourage us to bring it to you. Thank you, Lord, that you are there when we understand it and when we don't. Guide us now by your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. This is our second time on the book of Job. As usual, we didn't anywhere near cover everything last time, and there are some important things in that prologue of Job, those first couple chapters, that I want to make sure we pick up and don't lose before we move into the long journey through the poetry of Job. To start with, I wanted to mention the title of this series, The Color of the Night. You might have seen the footnote last time. This is Gerhard Frost's book, The Color of the Night, Reflections on the Book of Job. Sadly, I'm very sure this is out of print. If you ever do find a copy somewhere in a used bookstore or whatever, grab it. I think it's a wonderful book. It's not a commentary on Job, and so it won't satisfy all those kinds of questions that we might have. He does do a little bit of that, but mostly it's what it says, reflections on the book of Job. In prose, but verging sometimes on poetry. That's the kind of... Gerhard Frost was my teacher for Christian education at the seminary. He was one of those guys who was the most fantastic man to sit with, and you couldn't copy anything that he did. So I came out of that, I mean, he was one of a kind. You couldn't do Gerhard Frost. So I came out of that class knowing practically nothing about Christian education, but having had a wonderful experience with Gerhard Frost. Well, there you go, for whatever that's worth. I want to read just a few little pieces from the beginning. I know it's terrible pedagogy to read from books in front of a class, but I'm going to do it anyway. Here's how he starts his preface to the book. Grandma? Yes? It's been a bad day, a really bad day. I lost my best friend, and the teacher made me sit by myself because she thought I talked too much. On my way home, I made a snowball, and I threw it, and I told God I hoped to hit him right in the heart. But after a while, I told him I was sorry, and then things got a little better. The starkly honest telephone report of a day in the life of a seven-year-old, a one-minute dramatic summary of the book of Job. That's his beginning. As he moves a little further into the preface, he lists four reasons why he thinks the book of Job is worth studying. Why reflect on the book of Job? Sorry, worth reflecting over, not studying. First, because it nourishes our sense of wonder and helps us live with mystery, enabling us to let God be God even during God's silences. Second, we reflect on Job to deepen our level of inquiry and to share more fully in the asking of life's disturbing questions, to keep from mouthing simplistic solutions, here's my favorite line of this, and to avoid the impertinence of arriving without making the journey. To avoid the impertinence of arriving, quote unquote, without making the journey. Third, we reflect also to consider the perennial clash between frozen dogma and personal pain. The clash between frozen teaching, frozen dogma, and personal pain. And lastly, we reflect to better understand the struggle between faith and feelings, hoping to live less fearfully and more openly with suffering and with sufferers, that we may face more honestly the limitations of human counsel and be drawn into a new significant dialogue with people who are often misunderstood and avoided. Those are good reasons for Job, I think. He ends the preface by saying, Job's torment is maybe best exhibited by two words from Christ on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? And Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Job cries for Christ. There was one other piece. I'll share that this, here's his first of his reflections then on Job 1:1. There was a man in the land from the land of Uz whose name was Job. Here's what Frost writes. The road winds, it is a country road. I see a plowman against the setting sun. I lift my hand as I speed by. He lifts his in an ancient ritual. Hypocrite, to wave at one unknown to you and you to him, so says the cynic in my soul. To salute humanity and so confess that I was born and I too must die? It is not too much, nor is it false, between two mortals who dream one dream, the dream of loving and being loved. That's how he starts. That's Gerhard Frost. Okay. I'll bring in some other snippets of him from time to time as well. My second bullet on here, what do you think of God's bargain with the Satan? So just to refresh for you, in chapter 1, God's monthly council meeting going on, all the officers are there, and in comes God's quality control engineer, God's quality control officer, the Satan. And once again, that is a title here, the Satan, in Hebrew. The accuser, whose job appears to be to wander to and fro on the earth and check out the truth of people's lives and see if they really are what they say they are, and report back to the council. And so God brags up Job, this perfect guy who does no wrong and fears God and does what is right. Have you checked him out? He's a good guy. He's my servant. And the Satan responds, well, sure, you keep giving him all the goodies. Does Job fear God for nothing? Or does he serve you because you keep giving him good stuff? Take it all away and he'll curse you. So there's the question, and so that's what sets up this whole test, this bargain that God makes with the Satan. What do you think of that bargain? You comfortable with that?
Pretty unfair to Job.
Yeah. Pretty unfair to Job. You think so, huh? Yeah.
Isn't that the only bargain God ever made with Satan? Isn't this the only one?
Isn't this the only bargain that God ever made with Satan? It's the only one I know of. Anybody know of another one? And that even that is a question worth asking. Is this the kind of thing God does? If this is the only time we know of that God ever made a bargain with Satan, is this the kind of thing God actually does? Is this the kind of God you have? No answer. Yeah, sure.
We try to bargain quite often. Lord, I will do this, this, and this if you will.
Yes, we do. What do you suppose God thinks of our bargains? Okay. Now, one thing I think is important to see, the prose part of Job, the prologue and the epilogue, the first two chapters and most of the last chapter of the book that set the story, they're pretty crucial for understanding what's going to go on in between. Because now we know, as the hearers, as the readers, we know that Job is in fact blameless, that he has done no wrong. Now, we might honestly ask the question whether, in fact, there exists such a human being on the face of the globe. All the rest of the Bible raises that question for us. But at least within the book of Job, we know Job is blameless, right? So whatever else we read, whatever else the friends will accuse him of, or any questions that get raised, we know all along that Job is in the right. Why won't God ever tell him so? Why won't God ever break through and say, Job, this is a test, don't worry?
Then it wouldn't be a test.
Then it wouldn't be a test. In order for this to work, Job cannot know what's going on. Job cannot ever know what's going on.
Is this a test of God by Satan, though? To see what he can get away with or not?
Is this a test of God by Satan to see what he can get away with? What do you think? Who's being tested?
Both. God and Job.
God and Job.
So is there some context of what happens with Satan after this that's part of the story or not?
One of the things that we struggle with, the question is there some context of what happens to Satan after this? One of the struggles that we have is that there's actually so little in the Bible about Satan. There are a few fragments here and there, and they don't all fit together into a coherent picture. The church over the years has built up its own teaching about Satan from fragments here and there all over Scripture. And so we've got this sort of Satanology, this story of the devil just for example, if I raise the question, when did Satan fall from heaven? What would you say?
When Adam and Eve sinned.
Or before Adam and Eve sinned. Yeah. The only two places I know of in the Bible that actually talk about Satan falling are one in the Gospels, when Jesus' disciples come back from their mission trip, and they're all excited, saying, "Even the demons are subject to us in your name, Lord. This is great stuff." And Jesus says, "Yeah, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." Is he saying, millennia ago, or is he saying, when you were out there doing your work, I saw Satan fall from heaven? The second place it shows up is in the book of Revelation, in Revelation 12, where in the images of the book of Revelation, it depicts the birth of this child to the woman, this child who will rule the nations with a rod of iron. And all the allusions make it clear that this child is Jesus. The woman giving birth you can either construe that as Mary or you can construe it as Israel. It can work either way. But the woman gives birth to the child, and the dragon is there. The dragon then gets identified as the great serpent and Satan. The dragon is waiting to devour this child as soon as it's born. But God snatches the child and the mother away so that they can't be hurt by the dragon. And the dragon, in great wrath, kind of blows a gasket, and at that point there's war in heaven. So right after that, there's war in heaven. Michael and his angels throw down the devil and his angels, and now the devil's running wild down here, doing harm all over the place. When, according to Revelation 12, when did Satan fall from heaven? After Jesus was born. That's what the Bible says. That's when Satan fell. The story that we've built up doesn't work. And I think it's absolutely maddening. God must think it's delightful or something, not to inform us about all the details of this. So really, all you get in the Old Testament are a few fragments here and there. Mainly this one, where if you look at just at this story, Satan is part of God's council meeting. And seems to be the one who's checking out the reality. I call him the quality control engineer. And is not really a devilish kind of character in this one. A second place he shows up is in the prophet Zechariah, right toward the end of the Old Testament time. And there the prophet, there Satan is standing, accusing the high priest of sin. And God's angel steps in and counters him. So there you, that's really the Satan that I know, the accuser, the one who shows me what a schmuck I am. Is there another one? There is one more in Chronicles where the book of Kings says that God incited David to take a census, and the book of Chronicles says, no, it was Satan that incited God to take up a census. That's another one to sit easy with you. Okay. It really wasn't until, we really don't get a whole lot of detail about Satan until Jesus. Until Jesus talks about the ruler of this world that he's challenging and countering along the way. So it's the whole issue of the what is the story of Satan? What's the backstory? How does all this happen? We're left with just these fragments that don't all fit together.
Does Satan appear in Job beyond
this verse, the 12, when so Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. So he's done in the whole book. Okay.
Yep, he's gone in the whole book after that, and doesn't even show up in the epilogue.
Right.
That's it. So he's gone from the scene.
So is this part of God's plan for Jesus to expose Satan to the as more of a real threat to the community as a whole?
I guess I'd have to say yes, that Jesus takes this power, whatever this power of Satan is, Jesus takes it very seriously and speaks of it pretty openly, which suggests to me it's something important to be aware of. And Jesus clearly defeats it so that we are safe in him and able to live and counter that those kind of powers ourselves, which is important. But yeah, why it should come, why Jesus should flush it all out at that point when it was so...
Well, why Jesus, though? See, God, this is his point. Yeah. Puts Jesus on earth to prove, kind of, to people that are non-believers or whatever. And so, and this allows Jesus to show, you know, things the way they are in a more real fashion.
Mm-hmm. Another possibility is there certainly was a growth over the centuries in fascination around spiritual powers before Jesus came. So really from just about the end of the Old Testament period to the time the New Testament starts, there's this fascination with angels and with demons and with all kinds of powers around us. And some of those writings just go wild. They're just wild speculation and naming hosts and ranks of demons and all their jobs. And somebody had too much time on their hands, I think. And it may in part be that Jesus is trying to counter the reality of that power, but then also set all that nonsense in its place to kind of curb it. And the New Testament is really restrained about all of that. And we get the clear message, we have nothing to be afraid of, which is important.
So you're talking about the apocryphal books?
Yep. Yeah, the apocryphal books, Old Testament apocryphal books. Yeah, they're pretty wild. If you want some good reading on a Sunday afternoon, don't read them right before bed, though. Okay.
Now, are they in the Catholic Bible and not in
that? No, these are... The Apocrypha that's in some of our Bibles and that's part of Catholic and Orthodox Scripture is those are books that were accepted as Scripture in some communities, but on a secondary kind of level. Most Protestants have not accepted them as Scripture. There are other books beyond those that didn't even make that cut. That those are the ones that are filled with all this stuff. Yeah. Okay. Let me just give you a chance to raise anything that you wanted to raise from those first couple of chapters before we go on.
Yeah, and where would you find them? Where do you find them to read?
I've got them in my office. You'll find them, the kind of technical term that's used for them is the pseudepigrapha, with a P in front of that. The pseudo as in false. The false writings is what that means, this pseudepigrapha. So these are some of the other Jewish and Gentile writings, mostly Jewish, that were floating around in the time between the Testaments and later, that didn't make the cut. But they're out there, and the New Testament will refer to them sometimes. There are a couple of places where you'll see, as so-and-so said in such-and-such a book, and it's not in our Bible, where did you get that? They were quoting some of that stuff. Yeah, so there are, you'll read a passage in, I think it's in Jude, or is it in Peter, I forget which, about when Moses disputed, no, the angel, one of the angels disputed with Satan over the body of Moses. Where did that come from? One of those books. So you can find that stuff online if you wish. That's probably the easiest place to get it now if you just plug in, if you can spell pseudepigrapha. or Old Testament Apocrypha, or something like that. You might find all kinds of stuff there.
There's a compilation called The Lost Books of the Bible, but it's kind of misleading because they never were in the Bible.
They never were in the Bible, yeah. Yep. Okay. I'll go on record as not, I don't take the story of Job as historical.
As what?
As historical. Hysterical, yeah, not historical. My general approach to narrative in the Bible is to take it as literal and historical whenever that seems to be the intent. When it's pretty clear that it's something else being told, like when Jesus tells a parable or something like that, I take his telling them as historical, but I don't take the story itself as historical. He's telling a story, okay? That inevitably, to take that approach in the Bible means there are going to be some writings that get debated that way. Is this meant to be history? Is it meant to be parable? Is it meant to be something else? I personally take the story of Job in Job 1 and 2 and 42 as a setup story, not as history. Now, it's not going to finally matter one way or the other, but the reasons that I do are several. One reason that I take it that way is because Job is perfect. He is blameless. And according to the rest of the Bible, there ain't no such person. So it seems to me that we've got a setup here already of someone who's too good to be true. And that's part of the point. If we're going to debate the teaching that you reap what you sow, then what do you do if you have a blameless person, one who has done no wrong and yet suffers? So that story is set up that way. A second reason is that that this is not the kind of God that I believe in. This is a God who would make a bargain like this with Satan just to prove a point and destroy a person's life like that. I don't see that anywhere else in Scripture, God being that kind of a God.
What
point? Pardon me?
What point? To prove a point, you said.
Within the story, it proves the point that there are, in fact, human beings that will serve God because God is God, and not because of any goodies we get out of it. It also serves to vouch for God's honor, and it serves to vouch for Job's honor. And so it proves all of that at a pretty high price. Now, I'm not God, so I can't say that God could never do such a thing. God can do whatever God decides to do, but to set it up in this extreme kind of fashion, I don't see God acting that way in the rest of Scripture. But the story has to set it up this way in order to make us know that Job is suffering totally innocently and can't know why, can never know why. But what is true about that is that there will be plenty of times that we suffer and we don't get a reason for it, whether we believe there is one or not. Suffering is part of the story, and we don't get an answer.
But it's okay if we do accept it.
Yes, it is. And I will not. So it's. I know that there are many of you will take this as history, and others of you will not. This is one of those boundary places in Scripture where I think we're going to debate around it and not come to the same conclusion. But I'll just say it. That's where I am. Job.
You say that Job is blameless, and that word is repeated throughout the book, but Job defends his own integrity. Mm-hmm. But by the time you get to chapters 12, 13, 14, he's talking about that perhaps there were sins in his youth. What he's saying is that he has been loyal to God. That's his integrity, which may be different than innocent. Or, again, that term blameless is kind of fluid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's, I think that's really what you have to do if you're going to take this as history. Because otherwise it flies in the face of the rest of Scripture that says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You have to look at it, find a different way to talk about Job's blamelessness as and there are different synonyms in that. But we'll watch as we go through. Let's see what Job claims about himself in the poetry. So I don't know if I'm in trouble now or not. The other side of this that I want to hasten to say is that I believe this is God's word.
We just like seeing you confused.
It happens a lot. I listed a bunch of passages there next. I'm not sure how far we'll get today, but I've listed a number of passages there about Leviathan, who we looked at briefly last time. Leviathan, chaos, and the sea. And just to recall that for you, in the myths of the surrounding culture, every year, and the world had to be renewed every year, New Year's Day, the world had to be, in essence, recreated because it fell back into chaos every year. And the sea was feared by these people. The sea itself was an emblem of chaos, an emblem of uncreation. And so for the waters of the sea to come up over the land, to violate that sea-land boundary, that was a terrifying thing. Just remember that kind of stuff when you read the stories of Jesus on the sea with the disciples in those storms. Here's chaos rising up again, and Jesus conquers it just like that. So every year, Baal, or his sister Anat, had to reconquer the chaos monster in the sea. That chaos monster had several names. Leviathan is one of them. Another one that you'll see several times in the Bible is Rahab. Now, unfortunately, if you are the Jericho prostitute, her name is almost identical. She's not the chaos monster. Okay? She was a good person. Okay, she was one of the saviors of the story. It's two different kinds of H's, so it's not exactly the same. But the name Rahab often comes up in connection with Egypt. And so as God cuts apart the Red Sea and Israel can cross through, that story doesn't use the name Rahab, but Rahab is used later on to talk about the chaos monster in an Egyptian context. And so at one point in the book of Isaiah, when Israel is tempted to make an alliance with Egypt and trust them for help, Isaiah calls Egypt Rahab, who does nothing, the chaos monster that doesn't do anything. So the Rahab is Leviathan in an Egyptian context. You'll see language of the serpent, language of the dragon, and then several passages where you see it paralleled with the word sea, where the sea is clearly the chaos enemy. And it's interesting that Job is so full of this language, because let me ask you, why you think Job would be full of the language of the chaos monster? He lived in that culture. Yep, he's a non-Israelite living in that milieu.
Wasn't he experiencing chaos himself?
His life was coming apart. His own life had become chaos, had become uncreation. And so that raises the question throughout this book then of what does God the Creator do with our chaos when our life has become chaos? But we'll just watch that language as we go through. Okay, Job chapter 4. After being silent for 7 days, Job's friends begin to speak, and that's their first problem. So the first one that we meet is the oldest and wisest of the three, the most refined of the three friends. Would someone read for us, please, Job 4. Verses 1 through 6.
Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered, "If one ventures a word with you, will you be offended? Yet who can keep from speaking? Behold, you have instructed many, and you have strengthened the weak hands. Your words have upheld him who was stumbling, and you have made firm the feeble knees. But now it has come to you, and you are impatient. It touches you, and you are dismayed. Is not your fear of God your confidence, and the integrity of your ways your hope?
Thank you. What do you think about Eliphaz's approach? What do you like? What do you not like?
I like the fact he sort of starts gently. If one ventures a word with you, you'd be like, no offense.
How would you hear that? If someone said that to you, how would you respond? If I venture a word with you, will you be offended? Anybody not on the defensive yet?
Well, I think it shows that the guy knows that he could be offended by his words. So it kind of, to me, it's not an attacking sort of approach. It's a gentler sort of approach.
That certainly seems to be his hope. He doesn't want to offend Job, and he's aware that his word might. Mm-hmm. Can I speak with you? I think I need to say something, but I don't want you to be offended.
Yeah.
We all know how well it works, but he's trying. Okay, what else do you think about Eliphaz's approach?
Well, I think it speaks to the fact that we always think we need to find a reason.
Yeah.
For what happens.
Yeah, we need to find a reason for what happened. Why do we? It's true. We're always struggling to find a reason for what happens. Why is that?
Keeps us in control of our lives a little bit more.
Keeps us in control of our lives a bit more, sure.
And that's all human nature.
Why is it human nature? Maybe another way to ask it is, what would happen if we actually said, maybe there isn't a reason? What would happen then?
We'd be more accepting of Christ.
We'd be more accepting of Christ. Okay.
It's the only way.
Mm-hmm. What would happen to your approach to life? You'd be more trusting of?
Of that you'll get through things, that God will be there for you, that things may not be known to us, but they're known to Him.
Mm-hmm. You really are forced to put your trust somewhere else then. Yeah? Or else?
Despair.
Despair. It's chaos. It's chaos. Yeah. It's all random, it's all chance, it's all stupid, dumb luck.
Also at this time, wouldn't it be though that if you're putting your faith outwardly, that it's setting you up for ridicule in some aspect?
Setting you up for?
Ridicule?
Sure. Yeah, if you put your faith in something and it doesn't play out.
A tangible thing to it.
Yeah, so this is a fearful, and we still struggle with this today, don't we? When something happens, there's something in us that wants to scramble to know why it happened and figure it out.
How many places in the Old Testament does God say, if you will do this, this, and that, then I will be with you?
Mm-hmm.
And these people are schooled in that.
Sure.
And to make that switch to accepting Christ is a big deal.
And just all of the you reap what you sow stuff that they've been deeply schooled in as well. Yeah, there are consequences. Okay. Verse 5, but now it has come to you. How do you hear that?
Well, you've had it really good all this time, and now that you're getting tested, you've got pretty impatient and
You've had it so good up till now. Now it's your turn, and you're pretty impatient about this. lost myself here. Let me read you a little bit. This is from Frost on these verses 3 through 6. Eliphaz isn't a gross character. Intending to be gentle, he begins carefully with a little preamble to cushion what he's about to say. But he speaks as one whose mind is made up. He neither asks nor listens. His attack is thinly veiled. Perhaps in a more manageable situation, he would be considerate and sensitive. But like us, when drawn beyond his depth, he becomes cruel. Isn't that an interesting sentence? When drawn beyond his depth, he becomes cruel. Interpretations of the speeches of Job's three friends vary, but on one thing they agree. Love is missing. The counselors don't try to hear Job. They rush past him and run over him, ignoring him as a person. You have instructed many, but now it has come to you. Job has become a statistic, one of the many. It has happened to you. This is a damning word because it speaks in generalization, and love refuses to generalize. The word it, so innocent on the surface, loses Job in the mass and robs him of individuality. When the sufferer isn't heard, violence occurs. When the sufferer isn't heard, violence occurs. In human need, the lover must run ahead of the logician, for the heart blazes trails where there is no road for the mind. What do you think? Okay, in the next verses, Eliphaz will make his point. Would somebody read for us 7 through 11?
Think now who that was innocent ever perished, or where were the upright cut off? As I have seen, those who plow iniquity and sow trouble reap the same. By the breath of God they perish, and by the blast of his anger they are consumed. The roar of the lion, the voice of the fierce lion, the teeth of the young lions are broken. The strong lion perishes for lack of prey, and the yelps of the lioness are scattered.
Thank you. What do you hear? What's his point? God's in control. Yeah. What do you think of that first line, verse 7? Think now, who that was innocent ever perished?
Lots of them.
Lots of them. Mm. Was that your gut reaction when you read it too? Who that was innocent ever perished? Well, I suppose in a theological sense you could say there are no innocents, but... is that the point? Who that was innocent ever perished? And how should Job hear this?
That it's his fault.
It's his fault. Of course it is, because and now here in verse 8 you actually get it literally, you reap what you sow. Those who plow iniquity and sow trouble reap the same. One of the dangers of you reap what you sow is that it's very quick, very easy to turn it around and say, if you reap something, you must have sown it. If trouble comes to you, guess whose fault it is. Yeah, it's a very easy step. And that's what he's doing. Who that was innocent ever perished? Job. Or just think of now, Job has lost all his children, right? His family has been wiped out. That's part of his opening chapters. Who that was innocent, Job, ever perished? What's he saying about Job's kids? How is Job supposed to hear this stuff? Why is Eliphaz saying such a horrible thing?
Make himself feel better.
He has to. His world's falling apart. If Job and his family are suffering for no reason, Eliphaz's world is coming apart. Verse 12, each of these different friends has a different source of authority for what he has. They all come up with the same answers, but they all do it with a different authority. This is a great passage. Now a word came stealing to me. My ear received the whisper of it amid the thoughts from visions of the night when deep sleep falls on mortals. Dread came upon me and trembling, which made all my bones shake. A spirit glided past my face. The hair of my flesh bristled. Isn't this great stuff? It stood still, but I could not discern its appearance. A form was before my eyes. There was silence, and then I heard a voice. What's Eliphaz's authority for saying what he says?
He had a vision.
Or a bit of undigested beef, or whatever it is. Okay. He had a vision in the night. Okay. And here's the message that the vision spoke. Can mortals be righteous before God? Can human beings be pure before their Maker? Well, you're going to hear that for those phrases over and over again in this poetry. Each of the different friends will say it at one point or another, and Job will say it. Job will agree. So this is one of those places where the poetry of Job agrees with the rest of the Bible. There is no one who stands righteous before God. Even Job in all his blamelessness. Job will say so in so many words. So even in his servants, namely his angels, that's the next line, God puts no trust. How much more those who live in houses of clay, whose foundation is the dust, is in the dust and who are crushed like a moth. Who's that? That's you. Okay. Yeah. So basic message is nobody stands righteous before God. Not even you, Job. Chapter 5. Call now, is there anyone who will answer you? To which of the holy ones will you turn? Surely vexation kills the fool and jealousy slays the simple. I have seen fools taking root, but suddenly I curse their dwelling. Their children are far from safety. Fools and simpletons meet with a bad end. I've seen it over and over, he says. What's he saying about Job?
He's a fool.
Now he's calling Job a fool. Okay. Verse 8. Now, Eliphaz is his friend. He wants to support Job. He doesn't want to see Job suffering. Clearly, Job did something horrible, or God would not be doing this to him. So, what's the solution? Verse 8. Would somebody read, please? Actually, just verse 8 is enough.
As for me, I would seek God, and to God would I commit my cause.
Thank you. The rest of the stanza goes on to talk about how great and majestic God is. What's the advice? What should Job do? Turn to God. Now, if you've been doing horrible things, what would that mean?
Ask for forgiveness.
Ask for forgiveness. Repent. Turn back to God. Turn back to God's ways. Job, you've been on a horrible course. Turn back to God. God wants to bless you and restore you. All of which is true, right? Except for the premise. Verse 17. How happy is the one whom God reproves? Therefore, do not despise the discipline of the Almighty. This is absolutely true. We don't like it. We don't like to be chastised. We don't like to be called up short by God or have our life reformed. It's not pleasant, but it's always a healthy and a good thing when God takes us seriously enough to call us to account and to discipline us. In whatever way that takes, it's always good. This verse is absolutely true. How does it come across? Job, you should be happy that God's taking you seriously and reproving you by killing all your children and taking away all your property and giving you horrible boils. I beg your pardon? And the verses that go on from this are also true. They're part of the biblical relationship with God. For he wounds, but he binds up. He strikes, but his hands heal. He will deliver you from six troubles. In seven, no harm shall touch you. So God may allow all kinds of things to happen to us to reshape us so that's at least a possibility in the biblical picture of God, that God could whether it's allow things to happen or send things our way in order to recall us and reshape us. That shows up enough times in Scripture. We struggle with it, but it's there. And if in fact God's in that, then when we turn and God restores and makes things even better than they were, that's a joyful thing that God takes us seriously. We seem to think it's okay for parents to discipline. Should it not be okay for God to discipline? Well, this is part of the biblical story. But truth aimed wrongly and aimed out of love is worse than falsehood. It's doing damage.
I think that I remember asking my dad, you know, why does this bad thing happen? Is it God that's doing this? And he always used to say, well, he allowed this maybe to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this actually goes on, but like discipline, like it's God that's doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I've always thought, well, if he allows it to happen, that doesn't mean he's really doing it. It's just allowing it to happen.
Yep. And when you finally get down to it, it's not much of a difference. If you read through the whole Bible, you'll find the kind of the ways that the Bible talks about it tend to shift over time. And the earlier parts of the Bible tend to depict God more in a hands-on, doing it kind of thing. Later on, God's disciplining gets more, it's like there's a step removed from it, and you see human agency, an invasion, or different things that happen. And so then we're more likely to say God allows it. And then there are times, by the time you get to the New Testament and others, when Jesus says, no, neither of those. There's something else going on here. It gets looser as it goes on, but it never removes that. God is still God. And if nothing else, God has created a universe where stuff can happen. So God's not off the hook, no matter how we look at this. And we don't solve it. Last verse of the chapter, verse 27. How would you respond if you heard your friend telling you this? See, we've searched this out. It's true. Hear and know it for yourself. Yeah. Okay. In the few minutes we have left, I want to, unless there are questions you particularly want to raise or issues you want to raise, I'm just going to pull out a few verses in some of these intervening chapters. Job responds next, chapter 6. And now we see his first, basically his first accusation of God. It's in verse 4. The arrows of the Almighty are in me. My spirit drinks their poison. The terrors of God are arrayed against me. What's he saying? God has attacked me. Are you comfortable with that language, or?
I think you have to take it in context of 2, though. Because in 2, he's talking about where all of my vexation are weighed and all my calamity laid in the balance. It's basically, if this was justice being meted out,
yeah,
then I would have the arrows in me, and that would be too much to bear. So I don't know if you can really pull that one out,
okay,
and take it as an attack. I don't read it that way as I read through from the text sections.
So if that were the case, that this is, yeah, then the arrows would be in me. I think it's a direct attack myself. But because it's poetry, it makes it a little more difficult that way. What I would say to you is that this, if verse 4 is really no different from what you'll read in all kinds of psalms, where the psalms accuse God of doing one thing or another. And in all of those psalms, God never slaps the person down and says, I did not. He's not cut that out. That's no way to talk to me, Almighty God. Those psalms are there, in fact, for us to, if that's what we are believing or feeling, those psalms are there for us to express that very thing. God, you have attacked me, and I think it's sick. It's not fair. I want you to stop. It's okay to say that to God. That's part of the biblical tradition. Verses 8 and 9, here's one of his first requests. Oh, that I might have my request, that God would grant my desire, that it would please God to crush me, and that he would let loose his hand and cut me off. What's his request?
Find somebody else.
I don't think it's find somebody else at this point. Finish me off.
Okay.
Finish me off. Enough already. My life is worthless. Just kill me and get it done. Next verse, this would be my consolation. I would even exult in unrelenting pain, for I have not denied the words of the Holy One. I have remained true to God. Verse 14 is Job's first response to what kind of friends he has now. Those who withhold kindness from a friend forsake the fear of the Almighty. You think you're defending God, but by trashing me, you are losing God. You're forsaking proper respect for Almighty God.
That comes back to that last quote you had in that book,
mm-hmm.
about the mind and the heart.
Yeah, that the heart runs ahead where the mind can't go. Yep. Verse 24. Job is, part of what's helpful to understand in all of this is that Job believes all the same things his friends do. He has the same doctrines, the same faith, the same understanding. He believes that you reap what you sow. And so he is absolutely dumbfounded as to why this is happening to him. He'll challenge it more and more as we go along. But he starts out in the same place the rest of them do. So verse 24, teach me and I'll be silent. Make me understand how I've gone wrong. How forceful are honest words, but your reproof, what does it reprove? If you really think this is true, show me my wrong. Show me what I did that so merits this. Tell me and I'll gladly repent. One more verse and then we'll need to quit. This is chapter 7. He's now talking to God, verses 11 and 12. Therefore, I will not restrain my mouth. I will speak in the anguish of my spirit. I will complain in the bitterness of my soul. Am I the sea or the dragon that you set a guard over me? Do you hear the reference? God, am I the chaos monster that you have to beat down? Why are you treating me this way? We're going to slog through this kind of stuff for weeks, can't you? This is exciting, huh? Let's pray. Gracious God, for all of the wonder and mystery of who you are, and for all the things that we don't understand and we can't make sense of, thank you for who you are. Thank you for who you are. We stand before you, Lord. Help us to be honest as we stand before you with our confusions, with our brokenness, with our bewilderment, sometimes with our despair. Thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.